the program.
What you talking about?
The program. The program. Get with the program.
Everybody clap to this.
Say what?
Get with the program.
Hello, welcome to Get With The Program Radio Show. I'm your host, Gary Jones. Get With The Program Radio Show is a multicultural, informative, relevant, and entertaining one-hour weekly show offering you a combination of diverse interviews with questions and comments. And always, we will act as a positive source of information. Now listen, if you want to be a guest on the show, all you got to do is log in to www.getwiththeprogram.biz. Shoot me an email, leave me a message. You never know, you may have a conversation that we would love to talk about. Or give me a call at 919-255-2757. Again, the number is 919-255-2757. Or shoot me an email, GaryJones16@yahoo.com. Again, or visit the website. You know what it is, www.getwiththeprogram.biz. Hey, it's always good to know that you're listening. Check this out. Before we get started, man, listen. A lot of stuff is going on in the news right now. Check this out. Countries reimpose lockdowns after coronavirus infection spike. Now, Dr. Fauci warns of avoidable suffering and death. Now, my thing is this. If this doctor is warning, this is the Trump's main man, you know what I'm saying? If these guys are warning you that there could be some aftermath or some after effects coming right after you let these people be free and go out in the community again, I mean, what do you say? I mean, you gotta listen to this doctor. And, of course, him and Trump, they're clashing right now. So, from my understanding, they're not agreeing on certain things because Trump is ready to open the country back up. Dr. Fauci, he's saying, hey, we're not ready yet. It may not be exactly ready, but we're going to see what's going to happen with this because this whole thing is going to be interesting. Also, Paul Manafort released from prison to escape the coronavirus? I mean, get out of here, man. How you gonna let this guy out of prison and everybody else is still in prison, but he gets out because he's trying to escape the coronavirus? What about the rest of the prisoners? I mean, Jesus, man, come on. You can't just let him out and keep everybody else in there. So my thing is this. What if you are in trouble and you have some crime going on, you done committed a crime, how can you be released from prison and everybody else is locked in now? One day, unless they're going to release him and put him in some other place, some other solitary confinement, but we're going to see what happened with that. But before we move any further, I got to reach out to my good friend, comedian Grave Digger. Grave Digger, talk with me, man. You talked earlier to me about the side pieces. Let me know what's happening with the side pieces.
Yo, what's up, Gary? How y'all doing out there? This your boy, Grave Digger. Yeah, I'm back again, but dealing with this covert, whatever it is, virus that's going around and stuff. But, you know, what's getting me is, I just got my stimulus check. Y'all got y'all stimulus check? Man, they voting today to get you another stimulus check. I tell you what, we getting paid like big time now that the virus is here. You know, hey, but look here. They sending out virus checks. They sending out stimulus checks. They sending out all these checks. I ain't seen no check for side pieces. You know what I'm saying? Side pieces need their money too. You know, they got to stay by themselves and stuff because all these husbands got to stay at home with their wives. And y'all notice some crime, domestic crime is going up because fellas ain't used to staying home with their wife all day. You know what I'm saying? And then the side piece, she's supposed to be getting her side piece check. Because, you know, side pieces are used to getting that half a tank of gas a week, going down, getting that pawn shop jewelry. You know what I'm saying? Side pieces, you know, getting two or three of their nails done because the fellas can't pay for a whole set. You know, I'm going to have to call them, tell them, get that side piece stimulus check out. You know what I'm saying? But look here. I done hollered at Gary for a while. I done hollered at y'all. Y'all be hearing back from the grave and still doing the thing, rocking the house. Y'all enjoy yourself. Gary, it's back to you, bro. I holler at y'all. Peace.
All right, Grave Digger, boy, you is stupid. You are straight sick, man. I don't know what I'm going to do with you, man. But you're right about the side pieces. Because, see, at the end of the day, what people don't understand, we know we're locked in our homes. Coronavirus got everybody locked down. So, which means the salons are not open. And the side piece women, they ain't got no money. So, what they're going to do, they need some money. Side pieces, I guess they need to give them a stimulus check as well, right? So, the side pieces need a stimulus check. So, from my understanding, like you said, there's going to be a second wave of stimulus money coming out. So, these side pieces, I don't know what y'all going to do. Y'all got to get some of that bread, right? It is what it is. Side pieces need a stimulus check, too, as well. All right, check this out. I got to reach out to my good friend, Steve Rao. Steve Rao, man, tell me what's going on in the politics. I know you got some good information. Keep me focused. What's happening, Steve Rao?
Well, I tell you, Gary, it's great to be back. Sorry, it's been a little hiatus. Where do we start? I mean, first of all, let's just start at the most disruptive. Surgeon General Adams a few weeks ago said we were in a Pearl Harbor moment. And tell you, we're fighting a war, and this is an economic war. It's a healthcare war. And the casualties, I mean, today we have in the United States of America, we have an incredible amount of death. So, you know, there's more people that have died from COVID-19 than anything in the world, more than a war. It's the number one killer in the United States. And the tests are, you know, more tests are coming, but the more we test, we're getting more positive tests. And so it's just amazing, what we're seeing. But in addition to the casualties, Gary, what's amazing is the economic repercussions. In the 2008 recession, we lost 800,000 jobs. And I'm going to have to brace myself when I give this number, because today in the United States of America, we have had 37 million unemployment claims. And in our own home state, North Carolina, 1.1 million. So I think a lot of the fear is, as we reopen across the country, with Dr. Fauci saying that we're opening up probably a little bit too soon, but the president wanted to reopen. In Wisconsin, there was a Supreme Court case where they basically ordered Wisconsin to reopen, and the governor is not happy about that. But beaches in North Carolina are opening, restaurants are opening. In North Carolina, it's a phased approach. So our governor here is saying that, you know, phase one would be like, you know, reopen, takeout restaurants, no gatherings more than 10 people, and then you do a phase two and then a phase three. And it's all based on benchmarks, the number of cases that are leveling off in hospitals, the number of new cases declining. And right now it's looking good for North Carolina, but around the country, like in areas like New York, still a challenge. And I think the biggest shortage is personal protective equipment, masks, gloves, gowns. So if you're listening to this radio show and you have the ability to provide that equipment, please, there's portals being set up around the country where you can provide that. And I tell you, Gary, I've never seen something like this in my lifetime, in our lifetime. And I think we just have to look and see. At the end of the day, I'll end my commentary with just sort of looking at what I call the post-COVID world. When we beat this virus, right now we're about 18 months away from a vaccine. We've got Remdesivir, which is a Gilead company, Gilead Pharma in California. They've got FDA approval for taking their drug Remdesivir, which was actually created in North Carolina. And they license the technology. And then you've got a lot of these other companies that are emerging, many of them from RTP in North Carolina, but around the country. But at the end of the day, until we get a vaccine, I don't think we're going to be back to normal. So the question is, what's going to happen to movies? What's going to happen to football? What's going to happen to baseball? We've got limited schedules coming. What's going to happen to schools, right? How are we going to keep buses clean, trains clean? The thing that worries me the most is, up until today, with the global economy, cities were thriving in America because people from all over the world would come here, to Atlanta, to Charlotte, to Chicago. Are people going to start leaving the cities for number one reason, teleworking? That's my last point I want to make today. Twitter announced that they're not going to require you to go to the office anymore. Bank of America has 180,000 employees in the United States. They're saying they're going to move to a model where people don't have to work in the office. What's going to happen to the office building that builds a city skyline? What's going to happen when restaurants go out of business? And, there are business assistance programs. You can go to sba.gov/coronavirus if you're a company and listening to this, to get SBA loan assistance or personal protection program, which is you can pay a loan, 75% forgiven if it's used for payroll. And then you've got in North Carolina, our home state, you've got Raleigh putting in $1 million, the town of Apex putting in $1 million. You've got Charlotte putting in money, and those are run by third parties that would actually take the grants and provide them to businesses. But at the end of the day, if businesses don't survive, it's going to have an effect on people going into the city. and, you know, what's going to happen when, you know, we don't have stimulating economies thriving in America. I tell you, the world's going to look very different. Gary Jones, you're the man. Thank you so much. I want to wish all your listeners out there all the best, and I'm proud to be a part of your team, and I'm learning every day out here fighting in the trenches.
Steve Rao, my good friend, man. You always keep me abreast with some good political news. Good commentary, Steve Rao. Hey, Steve, you know what? I'm looking forward to hearing back from you next week. I know you're going to bring some more interesting stuff, man. Thank you so much. Once again, welcome back to Get With The Program Radio Show. Again, I am your host. Now, listen, today we're going to be joined in the studio with Gwendolyn Jones. Gwendolyn Jones is an educational trainer and also the owner of Clear Vision Consulting Group. Today, our topic is changing lives one day at a time.
One classroom at a time.
That's right. You know what, Gwen? You know what? You heard that, y'all, right? She corrected me on that one. She let me know what it is. Oh, that's right. You know what? Exactly right. One classroom at a time. Wow. One day at a time. You know where I got that from? I got that from because I was singing that song my grandmother used to sing.
One day at a time.
Sweet G. Yeah. I was singing that today. That's exactly where that come from.
Yeah. But
changing lives one classroom at a time. Hello, Gwendolyn. Welcome to Get With The Program Radio Show.
Hey, Gary. How are you?
I am good. How about yourself?
I'm wonderful.
Oh, man. Good. I'm glad you could make it because I know you've been busy. I'll check your schedule.
Well, I try to stay busy.
You're a busy person. Busy body. So, Gwendolyn, tell me something. I know you're busy. You got a lot of things going on. Tell me who Gwendolyn Jones is. Tell me about yourself.
Well, I grew up in Eastern North Carolina in a town called Wide Awake Wilson. You may have heard of it.
I've heard of Wilson, but you put the Wide Awake.
Well, they call it Wide Awake. So, I mean, I don't know.
I don't remember.
Probably because we always doing something in Wilson.
Wide Awake.
Shouts out to those of you in Wilson.
So we got the WAW.
Wide Awake. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, Wide Awake Wilson.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
Wow, that's interesting. So, learn something every day.
Yeah, my mom was a teacher. My grandma was a teacher. So it was inevitable that I was going to be a teacher. I started in middle school as a lateral entry math teacher, taught in the high school level, early college. I actually started in early college in one of the districts that I worked in. And it actually grew from 8 students to 32 students in 2.5 years.
Hmm.
Yep. I also was an assistant principal and STEM coordinator for a charter school in another district that I worked in. So I've been doing a lot of stuff.
Wow.
Instructional coaches.
Interesting.
Facilitator and all that good stuff.
So this is, I mean, being that your family was educators, it kind of just in your blood.
It's in my blood.
It's in your blood.
It's in my blood.
Wow.
So I was born a leader.
Okay. So you have kids?
I do. I have a 22-year-old son, and he has a 2-year-old daughter.
Mm-hmm.
I have a 29-year-old daughter. Actually, she came into my life when she was 15, but she is considered to be mine.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah.
Wow. Now, being that your mother, or their grandmother is an educator, you an educator, I bet they caught it then. I mean, learning how to speak, pronunciation,
yes.
English.
You would be surprised. Math. When you came into my house, I had everything labeled. You would come in and you would see words on the walls or refrigerator, stove, oven, washer, dryer. I'll never forget a friend of mine came in and said, somebody in here can't read. I said, that's all right. He can't read right now, but he will be reading.
Wow. You know, it's almost like me. I came from the church. My grandmother, we went to church every Sunday. I mean, it was like when they missed a Sunday.
Oh my God,
and then we even went to church through the week. You know, they got the weekly meetings, the monthly meetings, and all that, the prayer meetings.
Yes.
Man, I'm about like Steve Harvey. I said, Grandma, you just go ahead. I just really just go to hell.
Yes.
Just let me just
my
go ahead on hell.
I just
can't do it.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
Always in church.
Interesting. But yeah. So Gwendolyn, tell me about Clear Vision Consulting Group.
Well, this group is just me for right now, starting mm-hmm. out. I wanted to get into educational consulting because I've been doing this for now for a little over 20 years and needed to step out on my own.
Mm-hmm.
One of the jobs that I had in my career that was most rewarding for me was being an instructional coach, math science curriculum facilitator. I love working with teachers. What I would find out when I would work with them was it wasn't their pedagogy or it wasn't their content knowledge that they struggled in the most. But what it was their classroom management. And classroom management, the biggest component of that is building relationships with kids. So I just felt like I can touch a lot more students, a lot more, mm-hmm. a lot more educators, by being a consultant and Wonderful. Helping them with classroom management. So that's one of the platforms that I'm starting with my my business, Clear Consulting.
Wow, interesting. So what really motivated you to start such a company?
Well, if I have to really pinpoint what made me start it, of course, you know, being having an education background as far as my family. But I would say a lot of my experiences when I was growing up as a little girl, watching teachers and how they interacted with the students in the classroom, I would say that I could categorize the teachers that I had in the 13 years that I was in school as loved, liked, mm-hmm. or loathed.
Right.
loved, liked, or loathed. Yes.
Okay. All right.
And so I can think of this one teacher. Of course, I had several teachers that I loved mm-hmm. or that I liked. I had one teacher that I absolutely loved, and I loved her style. She was always doing extra stuff to make sure that we understood what was going on in the classroom. Mm-hmm. She would go the extra mile. I mean, her notes were always nice and neat. You know, how she spoke with us was always positive.
Mm-hmm.
But then there's that one teacher.
Always.
As that always. One teacher that I was like, but we never really had a run in, but the way she treated everybody else, I was like, that lady is wild. I would not if I were to ever be a teacher, I would never want to be a teacher like her.
Mm-hmm.
But then I did have a run in with her and it was kind of negative. And so I just made it my business not to be that type of educator. So, mm-hmm. I got a lot from the teachers that I loved and liked. I got a lot from my mom and my grandma. So that would be the beginning of me wanting to do my consulting business.
Wow. So how long you been teaching?
A little over 20 years, about 20. This is my 21st year right here.
So when teachers, you know, and this is just a off the book question here. When teachers have their students, is it a such thing as having a favorite student?
Some teachers do have favorites, but I don't. I try not to have favorites because I try to build relationships with every single one of them.
Mm-hmm.
And there are, now, don't get me wrong, I do have some kids that will run me raggedy, but I love them just the same. It's just finding out what makes that child tick.
Now, the grade levels you teach now, what are they?
I teach 7th grade math now in Wake County Schools. Mm-hmm. I started out in middle school, so I've taught from 6th grade to high school.
Wow.
And I did, I was an assistant principal and STEM coordinator at a charter school, which was a K-5 school.
Mm-hmm.
So although I didn't teach in that area, I was able to experience the elementary sector. So,
wow. So teaching math, I bet that's interesting. That was one of my toughest classes,
yeah.
Math. I just couldn't get math. And that's something that I think a lot of the African-American community suffer from, mm-hmm. is math. And mm-hmm. I'm so thankful that you're doing that. That's wonderful. Now, changing lives one classroom at a time. So tell me about that, because, you know, that's a real broad section right there. Mm-hmm. But one classroom at a time.
One classroom at a time.
Tell me about that.
So with me being in the classroom, I can change that one classroom. But when I step out and as an educational consultant, I can change many classrooms.
Mm-hmm.
Because we always want to make sure that we build relationships with kids. That's always one of my talking points when I go to a different district and I talk to the district leaders, the principals. You know, they always ask me, so what do you bring to the table?
Mm-hmm.
And I say, I bring my ability to create positive relationships with students and adults. I try not to meet strangers. I try to make sure that everybody is comfortable and confident in their own space, and knowing that they can achieve.
Mm-hmm.
So one classroom at a time is just, me stepping out into multiple classrooms and trying to help make a difference with the teachers that I work with.
So with this program that you're implementing now, like you said, there's a reason for it. You know, you have a motive behind it. So what are some of the problems that you find with our students in the classrooms today?
Well, one of the major things that I find with the students is their intrinsic motivation. Mm-hmm. A lot of kids are not just naturally motivated to want to learn. Mm-hmm. So, you know, we spend a lot of time as teachers trying to figure out what it is, what's going on with them in their lives where they're not feeling that. So, you know, trying to get them motivated to want to work, especially now with this COVID thing, mm-hmm. you know, we're branching out now into remote learning.
Exactly.
And so it's like, these kids don't see us anymore.
That's right.
So it's like, now they have to sit and get on their own. But they can still reach out to us, but it's not the same as being face-to-face.
Mm.
So trying to get them motivated now is a struggle.
It's a struggle. I can imagine, because kids today, they're very highly technologically savvy.
Mm-hmm.
They know how to play these things. Now, what are some of the challenges you find with training students who show resistance to wanting to learn? You know, because you have some students who you want to give them knowledge, but they show resistance to learning. Do you have a plan for a situation like that?
Well, one of the strategies in my business is teaching rules and procedures. One of the big things that we want to do at the beginning of the year, you want to spend that time teaching them, you know, rules and procedures and mm-hmm. how to do things. Mm-hmm. We can't just jump right into teaching
it.
Math. It just won't work.
Okay, yeah, because that definitely didn't work with me.
You look like one that probably wouldn't work with
you. I was like,
too.
Look, man, I don't know nothing about all this. You know, I got just enough to get through.
Mm-hmm.
You know.
Yeah, so part of my training that I'll be introducing to teachers is called Teach Twos, teaching the rules and the regulations.
Mm-hmm.
And there are a lot of strategies and rules and procedures, you know, like walking down the hallway or, you know, when the fire drill rings, what are you supposed to do?
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, it's just basic procedures, basic things that students should know. And we have to teach them those things.
Mm-hmm.
We can't just assume that they, you know, already know how to do it.
Right.
Yeah.
So how do a teacher, you know, I always wanted to know this. How does a teacher maintain a keen and calm mindset for managing a classroom? Because, you know, that's a job. I mean, you have 20 to 30 students in a classroom coming from different backgrounds and coming from different environments as well, different mm-hmm. cultures, different races, mm-hmm. and different parents mm-hmm. as well. So how do you keep a keen mindset for managing this?
Well, you just have to have self-control.
That's what I was going to say. See, me probably, I probably wouldn't have self-control. A couple of them probably wouldn't make it back home.
Yeah, I know it. I can imagine.
Like Bernie Mac said, you know, Bernie Mac said he'd knock him in the head. But no, I wouldn't do that.
Knock him in the head to the white meat. Yeah.
To the white meat.
But yeah, a lot of times we as educators and as adults, just as people, period, we have to have self-control. We have to realize that the best offense is a good defense.
Mm-hmm.
And we have to be preventive in the things that we're expecting the kids to do. So we have to have self-control ourselves to make sure that we don't overdo it or overspeak or make students feel that they're not being heard or you're not listening to them. Because mm-hmm. a lot of times, you know, kids, if they don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. Dr. Madeline Hunter once said that.
Mm-hmm.
So some of the strategies that I teach teachers is how to develop that mindset for dealing with problem behaviors and being preventive to make sure that those things,
interesting.
You know, those things don't
so,
happen.
So how do you effectively arrange and design the classroom environment? Because it is an environment. And, you know, I've been in different classrooms. And to me, teachers, I don't know where y'all get it from, but there's a strategy because each classroom that I've actually visited, because I've did some lectures, mm-hmm. and I see how the teachers have their classroom set up. Every place in the classroom is a learning tool or something.
Yeah.
The way you have your books arranged.
Yeah.
How do you go about setting up this environment?
Well, you always have to keep your kids in mind. And actually, that's another one of the strategies that, you know, that I train teachers on. It's called classroom ecology and arrangement. And believe it or not, lighting, where the seats are, where you move around in the room, all of that matters. I am one of those teachers that I like to change the arrangement in the classroom, the seating arrangement itself, every quarter.
Wow.
Because I don't want it. If I drive the same place, the same way to get to my destination all the time, it becomes monotonous to me. So I'd rather have something different. It's a change of pace.
Mm-hmm.
So it helps keep the students awake and alert, and not so that they get, you know, clicks form all the time.
I was going to say that, clicks.
Yeah.
Once you get that click.
Yeah. And then trying to break those clicks up, it gets kind of hard if you just leave them there the entire year.
They start strategizing on you.
Yeah, they will.
Yeah.
And then when you put them in group activities, and you got the same people that want to get together and run the class. No, honey, I'm the only one running this class. So
I guess you hear that.
Yes.
And that click thing is something. And you know what, Gwen, what we're going to do, Ms. Jones, we're going to take a break here. We're going to take a break, and when we come back, we have some more important questions for you, particularly the one I want to talk more about, students sitting together. How do you feel about students being in that click? Because, and what are some of the experiences that you've had when that happened, all right?
All right.
So listen, we're going to be right back in just a second. Don't touch that dial. I'll be right back with Ms. Gwendolyn Jones. She's an educator, trainer, and also the owner of Clear Vision Consulting Group. Today, our topic is changing lives one classroom at a time. Don't touch that dial. Be right back after this. Hey, this is Gary Jones, and you listen to Get With The Program radio show.
This is Wayne Goodwin, the former North Carolina Commissioner of Insurance and a former member of the North Carolina Council of State. When I listen to talk radio, I listen to my number one talk show, Get With The Program radio show with Gary Jones.
Hello and welcome back to Get With The Program radio show again. I am your host. Get With The Program radio show is a multicultural, informative, relevant, entertaining 1 hour weekly show offering you a combination of diverse interviews with questions and comments. And as always, we will act as a positive source of information all the time. Now listen, if you want to be a guest on the show, give me a call at 919-255-2757 or email me GaryJones16@yahoo.com or visit my website www.getwiththeprogram.biz. Again, today we are joined in the studio with Ms. Gwendolyn Jones. Again, Gwendolyn is an educator, trainer, and also the owner of Clear Vision Consulting Group. Today our topic is changing lives one classroom at a time. Hello, Gwendolyn Jones. Welcome back to Get With The Program.
Hey, Gary.
All right. You know, we had some good stuff going on here on that first half of the show. We talked about some good, interesting things. Particularly, one that stuck out to me a lot, though, Gwen, was students sitting together. You know, when you have the students that have a clique and they sit in the same place. Because when I was coming up, the seat that you got in the classroom was the seat that you had throughout the entire year.
Oh, my God.
When you went on a break, you came back. Because what we did, when I was coming up, you know, you wrote your name on the chairs, wrote your name in the seats, you know. And I can even remember, you know, I go way back. I don't know if you can remember this when, you know, during the times of heavy racism back in the days when teachers were going through a lot of stuff, particularly black teachers and particularly the black schools. Mm-hmm. You know, the books were hand-me-down books. You know, by the time we got the books, there was already white folk names written in the books. We got secondhand books, you know. So when we got together in a clique, you know, it was a clique.
Right.
With the books and everything, you know. So how do you really, you know, when that happens, how do you break that up, though? I mean, I know you say you move them around, but what happens if you come back in and they're trying to create this clique again?
Well, you try, again, it goes back to the relationships and what you do at the beginning. I always try to explain to my kids, we're going to change seating, so I don't want everybody to get too comfortable in one place. And once you start consistently changing the seats around and changing people around, and you always have to look at who you're putting with whom. You know, we have different personalities that just don't go together. And so we want to make sure we always have to look at our rosters and see, you know, how has this child been? How has he reacted? You know, what kind of trouble could he get in if he's sitting with this person? And what kind of trouble would she get in if she's sitting with that person? So we always have to be mindful of the different personalities of our students. in the classroom.
Mm-hmm. Have you ever seen an effect from one student to another student? Say perhaps you have a student that actually wasn't trying to learn, and there was another student who you knew that had potential, mm-hmm. and you saw the influence that one student had on another student. How do you break that? I mean, what do you do? Because they're friends.
Well, I mean, you have to play. You have to play into the strengths of each of the kids.
Wow.
So if I will pull one of them to the side and say, hey, I like the way you're working with them. Could you work with this other group over here? Because the way you answer those questions might help somebody else in another group. And you got to make them feel like what they're doing matters. You always have to make kids feel like that what they do, what they think, how they feel from day to day matters. Mm-hmm. And once you're able to do that, they'll do anything. They'll go that extra mile. Oh yeah, wow. I'll go sit over here. I'll sit with them, you know. And you know, that's always the positive that comes out of their social growth.
That's pretty good. So all the while there's two teachers. Now, are teachers trained for this, or they pick up on their own? Is there a training for this?
There is not necessarily a training for that. It's just about showing teachers how to build those relationships. It's just about listening. Some of the things that I talk about, I've always done. It's just dealing with people, mm-hmm. period, mm-hmm. you know?
And this is some of the strategies that your program present through your consulting mm-hmm. group. Mm-hmm. Wonderful. We're going to talk a lot about that, too. Now, students are constantly gaining knowledge much quicker due to technology. We mentioned that mm-hmm, earlier. Mm-hmm. Is it important to implement virtual technology and teaching in the classrooms?
Yeah, it's very important because with all the jobs that we have now and the different schools, we have art schools, we have technology schools. We always want the kids to know how to use the technology that we have. One of the things that Wake County did this year, of course, with this the pandemic going on, is making sure that all of the students had access to technology and hotspots.
Mm-hmm.
So my school, East Millbrook Middle School, we actually got all of our students a device, and if they did not have internet access, they were also given access to internet access.
That was going to be my next question.
Yeah, so mm-hmm. we have to make sure that it's there. So now that we see that it's possible for every student in the school to be one-to-one, the school to be one-to-one, there should be nothing that should stop students from using this technology mm-hmm. and being able to present anything using the resources that we have for them.
Interesting, because also we also understand net neutrality plays a very important role on being able to have access to the internet.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a lot going on with this now that they're home.
Mm-hmm.
And of course they have the smartphones, but they're going to need some laptops and desktops.
They need laptops, yeah.
Now, firmly but fairly, how do you carry out disciplinary actions?
Ooh. Well, one of the things that you want to do is to know how to respond to the challenges. You got to know how to refocus the students.
Mm-hmm.
You know, one of the big things is timing is everything. When you see little Daryl over there about to get into something, because he's always getting into something, you know, you got to decide how you're going to handle it
mm-hmm.
before it even happens. So, you know, part of my training is to show teachers how to intervene early and quickly to diffuse any situation that comes up without disrupting the learning behavior, mm-hmm. the learning environment.
Do you remember when students would get spankings in the classroom?
I do remember that. I think they stopped when I got to school because nobody ever put their hands on me.
I think they stopped exactly because, you know, if you didn't get a spanking at home, I mean, at school, you got one when you got
you
home.
You were going to get one at home.
Or your neighbors,
sir.
Back then the neighbors would beat you, you know?
Yes, sir.
It's interesting how this thing works. How do we build and maintain a strong student and teacher relationships? Because you have some students, You know, some of them, you know, you got to be able to have a relationship with these kids.
Yeah.
How do you do that?
And that's one of the main things I've been talking about mainly here today is just making sure that teachers know how to relate to students. Some people just don't. You know, one of the, I've worked in Pitt County as an instructional coach, and, you know, I've also worked in Wilson as a math and science facilitator. And one of the most rewarding things to happen is when a teacher comes to you and say, hey, I need classroom management. I need help with my classroom management. And I'm like, okay. So I'll go into their classrooms and I'll sit down and I'll look at the dynamics of their class and see what's going on. And lo and behold, it turns out to be relationships. Some teachers may talk a little extra hard to kids, and some people just won't say anything. You know, everybody has issues that they're dealing with, and how we handle our kids when they come in the classroom is big.
In the beginning of the year, you know, when they have the orientation, you know, I think that's an awesome time for the parents and the students and the teachers to get together and really get a clear understanding of what they're dealing with. Because a lot of the things that I definitely believe in when it comes to teaching, a lot of it starts at home. And if the parent is not doing their part at home, then of course the student is going to bring that action, whatever they learn, quickly to the school. So it's really important that the parents are definitely in on this. Now, I do want to ask you something about the curriculum. Do you think that the curriculum that is being taught now is fair and accurate for all races and cultures?
Now, that's a loaded question. I have to be careful and tread lightly on that question, but
get with the program.
Yeah, I'm gonna get with the program. to be quite honest with you, you know, different districts do different things, and they see, you know, people present their programs to different schools, and if the leaders, the superintendents, the directors see that it's something that could be beneficial, then they'll do it. They always look at research to see how has this worked somewhere else. Mm-hmm. So I believe that the decisions that are made from the leadership, I believe that they believe that it is equitable across the board.
Okay.
Some of the programs have proven to work well.
Mm-hmm.
But it's not until those programs get into the classroom where the teachers can actually say whether this is working for this group of kids.
I see what you're saying.
So a lot of times, and sometimes all programs don't work well for all kids.
Understood.
So then you have to try to figure out, well, what works?
Mm-hmm.
I'll never forget a couple of weeks ago, or right at the end of the, right before we got out in March, I was like, my kids just need some old fashioned teaching, you know, where I just need to stand in front of them and show them step by step what to do.
Mm-hmm.
You know, every now and again, old fashioned teaching works.
Works, okay.
All right. So having that and being able to, you know, go from one extreme to the next definitely helps.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Good answer. Now, teachers, we know, have changed over the years. The style, the whole thing has changed. I mean, you know, it's still teaching, but technology has changed over the years too, as we mentioned earlier.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Gwendolyn, is it important for the teacher to keep up with technological changes that constantly evolve? Is it important because you have some teachers who are not able to catch on to the technology, and some of the students are smarter than some of the teachers when it comes to technology? Because I've seen instances where some students can get on a computer and show the teacher how to navigate. So is it important to have training programs for that as well?
It is absolutely important for teachers to stay abreast of the technological changes that are happening, especially now. You know, right now we are in a place where we as the teachers are learning about how to provide remote learning for students.
Mm-hmm.
And you can only imagine the number of teachers that there are that did not know how to use Google Classroom or did not know how to use all these other resources. And so, you know, with Wake County and all these other districts, I'm pretty sure they're teaching their teachers how to do this stuff. So they're holding these professional developments for teachers to go in. If you need to learn how to use Google Classroom, if you need to learn how to use Illuminate, all these other programs and these resources that they have, they're training teachers now, and we're putting that all in place. So as the teachers are being trained, the teachers are training the students. So we're all learning this thing together. So, you know, this pandemic is really stretching everybody's learning.
That was going to be my next question, and you answered before I got there. My question was going to be, what was the education system really prepared for this COVID? Because now, you know, we're talking about being online, being distant learning is what we're talking about. Yeah. So were they really ready? Because like you said, there are some teachers, and even some of the hardware and software that teachers have at home, they may not even have good computers at home. Yeah. So I guess now the school system had to put computers in their homes, make sure that students have laptops or computers. This whole thing is costing money. But now I did hear the school system is the bills are a little lower now because the students are not in school. They're not paying for lunches. They're not, the bills are a little bit lower because they're not traveling with gas, the buses. Mm-hmm. They're at home now. So, which means there's extra money now that they should be able to provide for students with these laptops, the teachers, the training. All this stuff should be accessible now. It should be right there for them.
Well, the school system is always training teachers to be better teachers. They don't just let us in and then don't keep us.
Oh, good. You know,
keep
good.
Us trained.
Keep
so they're
trained.
Always providing professional development for us to learn. So that's one thing that every school district that I've been in, they've always provided that, you know, that extra training. You know, we're out of school. We'll go out and have a professional development during the day, and they pay us. We get paid
wonderful.
For that. So, yeah, they're always
on top of it.
Yeah,
good.
They're always on top
always
of it.
Always being innovative. All right, good deal. Good information right there for the community and the teachers. Now, let's talk about the program that you have going on and what's the plan for and how you plan to connect it with the children in the school system. Tell me about this program and how people can get involved in the whole thing.
Well, I first learned about this program. I was actually in the process of moving or looking at moving to a different state. And so, of course, I put my resume out on ZipRecruiter, and I got a lot of good, interesting feedback from some places that were looking at my resume and saying, oh, she looks good. And so I ran into this program or this company called Center for Teacher Effectiveness, CTE, and they have Time to Teach. And so I looked into them and I was like, oh, that's interesting, because they had that classroom management proponent. Mm-hmm. And so I was like, okay, well, I reached out to them. They called me. We had an interview. I interviewed with them and they were like, you will be an excellent fit for us. So would you come and train with us? And so I invested in myself because, of course, it costs to go. I went to San Antonio, Texas, to train with this group. I had a wonderful time there. I learned a lot of stuff. And this classroom management piece was right down my line. I've always had a classroom where it was just cohesive. When you come in my classroom, you would come in my classroom and it would, you know, it would be loud because my kids are engaging in their learning. And so I was just excited about working with this group. And so I am an associate with this company. And all these strategies that we've been talking about so far have been the strategies that they have put in place. So I definitely want to give them the credit for this layout. So that's what I've been doing. And being able to present this to different school districts and different school systems is what I'm all about trying to do now.
Okay, so the program, your program is actually, you you have a training method. You have a whole curriculum of actually training teachers how to be more effective in their classrooms. One classroom at a time.
One classroom at a time.
Wow. So this is good. So so I'm hoping that, of course, the whole school system gets aboard with this.
I hope so.
And so you actually go out and teach this program.
So, and I've spoken with a couple of principal friends of mine that are interested in me providing this professional development training for their beginning teachers. There are a lot of teachers, even there are some veteran teachers who are excellent teachers, but when it comes to managing their classrooms, that's where they lack. And if any school system could get a professional development training, this will be the one for them to have.
Wonderful. Now, is this local, national, regional? This is for everywhere?
This is for everywhere. This company that I am associating with is national and international.
Wonderful, wonderful. Now, if someone, if a particular school or a county school, or what about, do you do it with universities or just kind of on the high school level?
Now, that is coming into play now because some of the research is showing that some of the professors and teachers, instructors in colleges, with the students that are coming to them straight out of high school, it's different. It's a different dynamic,
Yes.
And so they're looking at trying to show those instructors how to manage a classroom because the kids now are coming with so much energy,
yes,
and so much different knowledge and. You know, experiences, and they're just a lot more bold now.
Right.
You know, coming in the classroom, when I would go in the classroom when I was in college, you know, with 40, 50, 60, 70 people, we would go in and just sit down and do as the instructor tells us to do. But now it's not
different.
Happening like that.
That's not happening like that.
And,
exactly.
You know, a lot of these professors don't have that training. So it is being looked at now to introduce this classroom management piece to the college level.
We have just a little bit more time here. If somebody wants to get more information about this program, about the whole synopsis that you got going on, the whole platform, the plan of this, where can they find this information at?
They can go to my website, and it is called gjonestrainer.com.
gjonestrainer.com. Wow, gjonestrainer.com. And they will be able to find how you know, pretty much your structure, your plan,
yes.
And also get in contact with you if they want.
They can definitely contact me. They can request information. There's a request a quote section on my website where they can click that and it just put in all their information, what they're interested in. They have my phone number. They can call my phone number. My email is up there. On the website, it even shows them the breakdown of a professional development all-day training from 8 o'clock until 4:30.
It's good information. Wow. Wow, a lot of teachers need to have this. The school system need to have this because I'm telling you, it's a lot of teachers, a lot of things are changing. The way the world is changing, now the kids are growing up, they're already smart. It's almost like babies are coming out and they already have phones in their hands as soon as they come out of the womb. They're already playing with the cell phone as soon as they come out. That's where this thing is going.
Yeah.
Wow. Once again, Gwendolyn Jones, as I said before, in the studio with me today. She is an educator, trainer, and also the owner of Clear Vision Consulting Group. Today, our topic was changing lives one classroom at a time. Gwendolyn, thank you so much for being
Gary,
here today.
Thank you for having me.
Really appreciate
this
that.
Really exciting.
Wow, we got to get you back in here.
Yeah.
Yep. Once again, thank you so much for being here. Thanks for tuning in today. I'm Gary Jones, the host of Get With The Program Radio Show. As I always say, stay positive, keep your head up, and remember to
get with the program.
What you talking about?
The program. The program. Get with the program.
Everybody clap to this.
Say what?
Get with the program.
It starts now.